to him on the meeting. Got it. I was introduced to him while watching June's talk, and I just felt the inspiration. So I feel like he's going to just bring it tonight, and I'm excited to listen to him. So without taking up or any more further ado, Bill, take it away, buddy.
Thank you, Sam. Veronica, if you would like to just continue reading the phone book, I'd be very happy to bypass this and you can just keep reading. It was a wonderful, wonderful message that you carried. Thank you. My name is Bill. I'm an alcoholic. I'm a member of the Back Porch International Group. And I want to thank my fellow members from, Montana, Chicago, Maryland, the UK. We're an international group, and we have a tendency to support each other, and I'm very grateful for that support tonight. Thank you all for being here. Sam, it's a joy and a privilege for me to speak at your meeting. I'm a bit of an academic, and so I really put my academic hat on tonight. So this will be a little bit different talk than what I usually give in terms of qualifying. I did a little bit of research, but I really, this whole idea connected with where I am right now in my own spiritual development. And it was a bit of a surprise about how much is coming together for me right now. And I don't know whether it's the pandemic or whether it's Zoom or whether it's just the right time in my life to be dealing with some of these spiritual issues around my sobriety. My sobriety date is November the 20th, 1983. That's a date that has a lot of meaning to me, probably not to anybody else here. That was the day that mysteriously God came into my life that I recognized. I'm sure he had been there a lot before. And I was able to stop drinking. And I did not think that I could stop drinking. I thought that I would maybe play around and, you know, do these meetings and talk to these people and eventually go back to drinking, because drinking was a major part of my life. What I really want to talk about, though, first is some of the emotional component of sobriety and connecting with Bill Wilson and Father Ed Dowling. I think Ed Dowling was one of those hidden figures behind the development of Alcoholics Anonymous. He was a Jesuit priest out of St. Louis. And he connected with Bill. Supposedly, just before World War II, Bill was in the midst of a depression, and he suffered from depression for most of his life. And Lois was out. He was by himself. They were renting a room at the 24th Street Clubhouse, the way the story goes. And there's this knock on the door, and in comes this bum that Bill thought was a rainy, cold night in November. And this guy stumps up the stairs, has a walking stick, and he takes off his jacket, and Bill realizes that he has a Roman collar on. And Father Ed introduces himself as a Jesuit out of St. Louis. And the two of them talk. And most important, I think, for us is that the two of them connect. And I'm sure all of us in our own way have made those connections at a meeting. I know myself, the tears will come or the laughter will come, but I make some kind of connection, whether it's in a face-to-face meeting or whether it's on Zoom. There's that emotional connection with the speaker, with the story, with something that is being said, and that's what happened to Bill that night. And Ed, Father Ed, became his spiritual sponsor and helped him as through the course of his sobriety. Ed died in 1960, so Bill was working on the 12 and 12. He would send copies of the manuscript, both the steps and the traditions, to Father Ed to review. And the two of them had this connection, and Bill would turn to Ed for advice. I can only tell you that pattern is something that I have tried to follow. in my own life and my own sobriety and talking to my sponsor and going to meetings and listening actively and hearing that message behind the message. For many years, I belonged to the East Milton group outside of Boston. And there were a bunch of guys who were sober a long time, who knew sponsors, who knew Bill and Bob, and they had that look in their eyes. And if you know what I mean, you know what I mean. And we would talk to them. It was an 8:30 meeting. It would get out at 10 o'clock. And by midnight, we were still there on the steps of St. Agatha's Church in East Milton talking about the program, talking about making amends, talking about how to do the steps. And that connection, it stays with me today. I haven't been back to East Milton in 20 years, but that connection of one drunk talking to another was very, very important. Turns out that Father Ed Dowling, in the course of his work, of his religious work, would kind of connect with AA, and he'd call up Bill or send a letter and say, where are the AA meetings in, you know, Chicago? Where are the AA meetings in San Francisco? I'm going to be there. I'd like to connect. And Ed was kind of a fellow traveler. He was somebody who was willing to go and do the 12 steps, even though he himself was not an alcoholic. He suffered from obesity. He suffered from arthritis. He referred to the pain he was in as his Gethsemane. And in a religious context, that was where the Christ went through that dark night of the soul before the crucifixion. And in Father Ed's case, he had a lot of pain. He was in the hospital a lot of surgeries. And it was his Gethsemane. And Wilson related to that. And that was an amazing fact for me that, you know, I have this idea of this, you know, Saint Bill in many ways, but I also realize, having done some reading and have being a historian at heart, that Bill had feet of clay. He wasn't necessarily the most faithful husband. He made a lot of mistakes. What he talks about, as I understand it, in the 12 and 12 in the big book, in terms of character defects, were his character defects, which I can relate to. And that takes a little bit of humility, because I don't want to own my character defects. I don't want to be that person who doesn't do everything right. I want to be, in Bill's words, the number one man. And, you know, as I've read about Bill, you know, I live in Vermont. I'm about 2 hours away from East Dorset, where he grew up. Bill's story is remarkable. And for the time, 1915, 1920, his father abandoned the family. His mother left he and his sister in care of his grandfather. His grandfather had served in the Civil War and fought at Gettysburg. So again, my historian's heart is pounding faster with all of these connections right now. But Bill was a sad young man, and I can identify with that sadness in many ways, and I'll get to that in a minute. But his grandfather was his support. His grandfather was his focus. And his grandfather one day said, you know, those Australians, they're so smart, they're able to create a boomerang, and no white man has been able to do that. That's my quote. I'm not exactly sure if it's accurate, but Bill heard those words and said, I can do that. And sure enough, after a lot of experimentation, he cut up the headboard of his bed. It was a maple headboard, and created a boomerang, which flew and came back. And his grandfather called him the number one man. And when I read that story, I went, gee, isn't that great? You know, because maybe something similar like that happened to me. And I'm racking my brain to feel that way. My parents were children of the Depression. My father served in World War II. They were distant. I come from an Irish Catholic family, lived in New Jersey for much of my early life. And we went to church regularly every Sunday. So there was a regularity to our life. What I say when I qualify is that my family drank, not my immediate family, but the family around me. If we would go to the Jersey Shore for a celebration, there were two refrigerators, one filled with soda and the other filled with beer. And my uncles and aunts, you know, playing the piano, dancing on tables, singing, having a good time, always with alcohol around. There's a memory that keeps coming back to me, and there are probably many reasons for it, mostly because I'm all of a sudden parachuting into my early years. And I very seldom talk about this, but I was raised a Roman Catholic and went to St. Mary's Church in Nutley, New Jersey. And there was a priest there who I was scared of. His name was Father Golding. And tall, big, bald, and I didn't want anything to do with him. And I don't know exactly why, but I remember him because every Sunday in the announcements, he would make a point of saying that there's an AA meeting here every Thursday at 8 o'clock. And I don't know if any of the other priests did that. And I don't know if he was in the program or not, but I remember that announcement. And I was in grade school, so, you know, younger than 13. And it was interesting. When I was much older and when I was sober, I went back to my family home and helped clean it out and sell it. And I found myself looking for a meeting in that, and I ended up at that church at that meeting that he had talked about. And all of a sudden there, I'm closing that spiritual loop for the first time in my life and feeling very comfortable about that. Some guy came up to me and asked me for my phone number, and we were trying to connect in the early days of cell phone service. And we talked a little bit on the phone, but all of a sudden I was back there as a little kid in that church, but now as a sober man, I was able to do my best to carry that message, which surprised me. I never thought when I was growing up that I would be able to do something like that. I had an aunt and an uncle, my Uncle Bob and Aunt Margaret, and I don't know why exactly, but they would take me out of my family and they would give me a weekend with them. And I just loved going to their house. I love that connection, the clean sheets and the showers and breakfast in the morning. And I felt loved in a way that I didn't really feel in my own home. Now, I'm sure my parents did the best I could, but as I said, they were a little bit distant. And along the way, I developed some kind of anger toward authority and toward the church. I can remember getting on the bus one day and some kid was bullying me, and I just wailed into him, and he was gone. And I realized that my anger could really get me in trouble, and my anger scared me. And when I talk about my character defects, that's always the one that's at the top, you know, my anger. I'm afraid of it. And so as I was growing up, I would tend to not engage with people and stay by myself and not respond when somebody said anything, because that incident in whatever it was, third grade, fourth grade on the bus, scared me. And it revealed a side to me that I didn't want to show anybody else. And as I got into the steps, of course, that's one of the things that I had to talk about. I had to confront a little bit more. And on a daily basis, I still do. And I'll get back to that in a few minutes. But I went to high school. I went to high school in Newark, New Jersey. I had to ride a bus, and there were situations there. It was in the 60s. the Newark riots were happening and the town was closed down. I saw pictures of the high school where I was there during the year, but in the summer of 67, there were National Guardsmen on the roof with rifles. And so that was the environment that I was growing up in. I got in a little bit of trouble before I graduated. I was supposed to go to a Catholic college in upstate New York. And because of my behavior, because of some situations that I had gotten into, that scholarship was pulled away and I didn't know if I was going to college or not. I ended up working for a trucking company at night, loading and unloading trucks. And I was with guys who were crazier than I was and angrier than I was. And I could kind of connect with them at some level, but I wanted to make money. And I wanted in some way to be that number one man, even knowing that I could never be at that top level. But I did get into college. I looked a little bit older than I was. I think the age was 21 to drink. And I could get served in a bar. And I was able to go in with friends, and they would be asked for proof of their age. And I was always just allowed to drink. I'm not exactly sure what HP was trying to tell me there, but my friends were always amazed that I could get served. And I controlled my drinking. For all of my drinking, I was unwilling to drink in public to the point of getting drunk. I always wanted to be safe when I drank. And so I would have one or two and literally force myself to stop. What I heard when I came into AA was that if you're controlling your drinking is controlling you. And truer words were never spoken. I was being controlled by alcohol and I didn't know it. So I finished, I left one college, transferred to another. I was not a particularly good student. A lot of Fs on my transcript, but somehow I managed to get through. I graduated a little bit after my class, and remember, I'm a more or less a Catholic kid, but I've kind of left all of that behind. I'm an angry kid. And so my one way to kind of move ahead with my life was to do something that I thought was okay. And that was to get married and move to the Midwest. And I'm not exactly sure where my thinking was. It was crazy thinking. The marriage lasted a couple of years. My ex-wife moved further west, and I was in the middle of Michigan looking for work, not being very successful, in the middle of that depression that Bill Wilson talked about with Father Ed Dowling. I would go out into the woods and look at the highway and drink and wonder what was wrong with my life. And that was the pattern, you know. I didn't know anything better. I did eventually get a job, and the boss that I had coincidentally liked to drink, and he would invite me to his home on a Friday night, and he was buying and I was drinking. I'm Irish and Scottish, and so I'm a cheap drunk. I love to drink, but I prefer that you pay for it. And he was paying for it, and we would spend the early part of the evening drinking. And then at some point his wife would cut him off and put on the coffee pot for me so I could get sober and drive home to my apartment. And what happened there is that I was just a wide awake drunk. I had a lot of alcohol, but I was wide awake. And what I had to do is to drink until I could fall asleep. I found out later that that was passing out. I didn't know it at the time, but that was how I dealt with life. Again, you know, more bad decisions. I moved to the East Coast. I kept drinking. I went to a graduate program in Boston, and you know, I kept drinking, and I got in trouble because somebody said, you know, maybe you need counseling. And so I went to a counselor, and one-on-one I was fine. And then the counselor said, maybe you need to try some group counseling. And I immediately got a resentment. I got angry, but I went, and I sat there for 2 or 3 weeks. And the third week, the counselor asked me one of those very personal, you know, invasive questions, something like, how are you? And I got up out of my chair, and I pulled him up out of his chair, and I shook him, and I threw him down. And I said, now we can continue with the meeting. And I was a little surprised, you know, when these guys in blue coats and batons and badges came into the room and very politely asked me to leave. And I could have gotten into a lot of trouble. I mean, that was, you know, more than a misdemeanor. But I left on my own. I didn't get into any trouble. That was my last group counseling session. And I went home, and I smoked and I drank until I could fall asleep. And somehow I got through that program. And when I say that I think God has been watching out for me, I really believe that the prayers of my sainted mother have really applied themselves over the years. Because I didn't get into any trouble. I just felt bad. I finished that program. I went to work in downtown Boston. And I had a reasonably good job for a management consulting firm. And I could see down below in Faneuil Hall how people would go out at lunchtime and have a salad and some white wine under those umbrellas and tables in the marketplace. And I said, I'm going to do that. I'm going to go down there and have a little salad and a little white wine. And one day I did. And I don't know what they put on that stool, but I couldn't leave. It was like this glue had me attached. And I had my salad and a white wine and another white wine. And I had to go back to work, and I felt conflicted. And eventually I pulled myself up, and I spent the longest afternoon of my life in that office, trying to work, waiting for 5 o'clock so I could leave, so I could go home, so I could drink. It's the first drink that does it. And it set up that compulsion for me. Just like Dr. Silkworth says in the Big Book, you know, that as soon as I consume alcohol, that physical craving sets in. I wanted it, I had it, and then that mental obsession was there that I had to have more, and then I had to keep drinking until the evening was over. I could fall asleep, which I found out was passing out. My life, I can't say it got any better. I had to leave that job. I was asked to leave. Not because I was doing a poor job, but because the way they ranked them when they had the layoff, I was at the bottom, and I was one of the ones that was asked to leave. And I ended up with one of my coworkers going out and drinking and trying to drown our sorrows after the layoff. And I ended up working, you know, lower level jobs. I mean, here I was with a bachelor's and a master's, and I was acting as a secretary, and it was not a fun time. But I kept drinking. I always had money to drink somehow. And, you know, one thing led to another. I ended up getting a job closer to my field and working for a high-tech company. And all of a sudden, this was where I think the grace of God came into my life. And it was very indirect. It was in one of those, you know, one of those ways that there was a series of coincidences. I worked with a woman, and she invited me to her family's house on the Cape. Her father and mother were there. We had a wonderful weekend, and we drank. And the father and I hit it off, and he invited me down for a week. on vacation. And I went down in, I guess, September, October, and we spent the week drinking, and he left after a few days, and I had my sailboat, and I wanted to go to the beach, and all I could do was to stay in that beautiful house and look out those beautiful windows at the beautiful sky and the ocean and keep drinking. And when I got back to my office, I had to make up stories of what I was doing for this week because I didn't do anything that I had planned. What I didn't know, and I think this is where, you know, God started to really work in my life and direct me into the program, was that that woman who I worked with had a friend who had a friend, and a bunch of us went out to dinner in Cambridge on a Saturday, I guess. And it was in November. I had had a terrible day. People were angry at me. I had offended them. I was in a lot of trouble, not legal trouble, but just people were not doing things my way. And you know, when we talk about the emotional sobriety and that dependence, you know, I was making demands on the people around me. I was trying to possess and control them, and they didn't really want it. And so it was bouncing back to me, and I was feeling bad. But I sat in this restaurant, and I was thinking about the day, and I said, maybe for the first time, I need a drink. And this woman was sitting across the table from me, and she said one word, "Oh?" And she proceeded to tell me that she was sober and Alcoholics Anonymous at that point for about 7 years. And she told me little bits and pieces of her story and how she came to sobriety. And I had my drink, I ate my dinner, and I went with this group of people, kind of follow the leader, to somebody's house. And they had, you know, these big urns of coffee and buckets of ice cream and platters of cookies, and nobody was drinking. And, you know, I felt like I just wanted to go down to the basement and start digging a hole because I felt terrible. You know, those people were so kind to me. And just like I experienced tonight coming into this meeting, and I've experienced in the last 37 years of coming into meetings, that kindness of one drunk talking to another. And they didn't accuse me of anything. They just stuck out their hand. A lot of the men gave me little slips of paper with numbers on them, their phone numbers. Give me a call. They talked about big books and 12 steps and AWOLs, and I couldn't figure out anything. It was like a different language. And I left that house that night. I went home. And that glass of white wine on Massachusetts Avenue in Cambridge on November the 20th, 1983 was my last drink until today. I am so grateful for those people who welcomed me. You know, our third tradition talks about the only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. I didn't have that desire. I had a desire for the trouble to go away. I guess HP interpreted that as close enough. Some people who were in the program told me that I didn't belong there. And, you know, when the back porch has a traditions meeting, and we just had a tradition 3 meeting this week, and boy, do I relate to that. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. And I am so glad that those people let me into their meeting, and they accepted me, and they embraced me, and they said it was okay. You know, that I didn't have to qualify. I didn't have to do push-ups or pull-ups or run around a track or something. I just had to say that I belonged, and I belonged. Even today, I can look back on that time and, you know, I can get emotional because it was such a powerful moment in my life. My life began with that last drink and with those people in that house. And I started to go to meetings, and it's interesting. I like to share this because it really connects for me with AA history. The meeting in Cambridge was at the Swedenborgian Church, which was connected with Sam Shoemaker and early AAs. And I don't know if anybody knew that at the time, nobody told me about the connections. All I remember is going to those meetings and sitting way in the back. And I remember hearing the promises. You know, you will know a new freedom and a new happiness. You will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. You will comprehend the word serenity and you will know peace. Wow. And I said, that will never happen to me. And at the same time, I can tell you today that it has. Just as Bill and Father Ed were able to move through their lives and go through that level of suffering that they each had to endure, I endured my level of suffering. And I was able to find some peace, some contentment in working the 12 steps. It took me a while. I can remember going to a meeting on the South Shore of Boston and Scituate, and it was a step meeting, and somebody was talking about the Baltimore Catechism, and all of my anger came up, you know, and how dare you? And, you know, one of those guys, one of those Eskimos who was always around, kind of pulled me aside at the break and said, it's okay. That's his program. Let him work it his way and you work your program, or words to that effect. I was so angry because I didn't want my spiritual program to be tarnished by this, you know, Roman Catholic religious idea of looking at AA. Who knew, you know, that 30 some odd years later, I'd be talking about the religious aspects of AA and reading spiritual books and talking about the connections between the 12 steps and, you know, the religious exercises, the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius, and reading Jesuits and talking about Father Ed Dowling. How does that happen? How do I get from where I was with all of that anger to where I am today? I have to believe that's a miracle. I have to believe that that's God at work in my life. I have to believe it's a product of the people that I've known and the meetings I've attended over all of these years that have chipped away at that hard rock that was me, that angry person, and somehow made me acceptable in little ways to society. I don't know how that happened, you know. All I know is that that there is a loving God, because he took pity on me and brought me to you people. And I know that the only thing that I could do in return is to show love for that sick and suffering alcoholic. And when the phone rings or when the job comes up at the meeting, to say yes and to serve as best I can. You know, there's a story in our big book called The Keys of the Kingdom. And one of the last lines is, in return for a bottle and a hangover, we have been given the keys of the kingdom. And I have, you know, I was married in AA. We had a Diet Pepsi wedding. There were AA people there. My wife is in the program. We had a lot of very happy years together. We went to a lot of meetings together. And at some point, we couldn't do it anymore. And we had to separate and divorce. And it was a sad time. And I was around 18, 19 years sober. And I ended up in Vermont as a result of that. It was a major life change. I had to leave the East Milton group and all of my friends, my sponsor. And I came to Vermont and I basically had to start all over again. Instead of the management level jobs that I had, I ended up working as a carpenter. And you don't know what pain and suffering is until you've worked as a carpenter through two Vermont winters and standing on a roof and, you know, putting in sheathing and insulation and freezing. And I had a job in November, my 19th year sober, and I was in a dumpster and it was filled with rebar that they wanted me to cut up with an electric saw. I was filthy. It was a dumpster. And there was mud and muck and everything all around. And it was a beautiful day. And I looked up and talk about, you know, emotional sobriety. I looked up at the sky and I said, okay, God, if this is where you want me to be, this is where I am. And I accept that. And I went home that night and I cleaned up and went to my home group at which was in Stowe at the time. And I received my 19-year medallion. Those memories are very, very vivid. And again, my higher power was at work in my life. You know, I went through another winter working in that job and received a phone call, and I ended up back in the field where I had gotten most of my degrees in. And that happened. I was back in an office, very grateful when it snowed and it was cold that I could be warm. And I was allowed to go back to school in the course of that job. And I had always wanted to be a teacher. And I had tried to do that in college. And as I told you, my college grades were not very good. And so that dream was abandoned. And somebody said, why don't you become a teacher? And I said, I'm too old. And somebody said, how old would you be if you don't become a teacher? How old would you be if you don't go back to school? And so I picked up the phone and I talked to this wonderful woman, and I said, well, I'm much older than your usual students. And she just smiled. I could feel it through the phone. And she said, some of us are. And I went back to school. It was a year program. I did it in two because I was trying to work my program as well. It was difficult. I had to break my anonymity with one particular professor because of the nature of the work that I was doing. And I talked to my sponsor about that, and he said it was okay. And I finished that degree. And for the last 13 years, I've been a high school teacher, and I work with immigrant students. And not all of them are qualified to speak English, although many of them do, and they do it well. But they require some intermediate work in reading and writing, and that's where I come in. And excuse me. And I find that the empathy that I've developed in Alcoholics Anonymous by sticking my hand out to that sick and suffering guy who walks in the door and giving somebody a hug is directly correlative to the work that I do with these children. And I think I have the best job in the world. The pandemic was really a challenge. I don't think they got the education they deserved, but at the same time, I was there when I was supposed to, when I was on the phone, and I talked to them and I gave them as much support as I could. In the course of doing that, I realized that I wanted to go back to school for another degree. And so I spent 5 years in school working on an educational leadership degree, and I got a doctorate. And I'm looking at a photo right now of that graduation day, and I'm surrounded by these kids. And they're smiling and they're wearing hijabs, and they are there to celebrate me. And I never thought that would happen. When I was growing up and I was going through all of those difficulties with all of my anger and, you know, wanting something else, I never thought that I would end up where I am today. There is a guy at East Milton, and he talks about where there's faith, there's love, and I have faith. And where there's love, there's peace. And where there's peace, there's God. And where there's God, there is no need. And on a daily basis, that's what I feel. You know, I can look at the 12 and 12 and I can read my big book, and I can go through all of my literature and I can do my spiritual exercises. And yet when I get up in the morning, I have that morning madness that sets in and I feel crazy. where all the good things that have happened just disappear. And I feel like that crazy person I used to be. And I get down on my knees and I say something that sounds like, God help me. And I've been saying that prayer for a long time, God help me. And I say the third step prayer, and I say the seventh step prayer, and I say the St. Francis prayer. And somehow in the course of those prayers, I start to feel better. Not immediately. Sometimes I'm on my way into work. Sometimes it happens at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock. But I have that peace and it comes to me, and I have to believe it's because of that prayer or those prayers. You know, St. Francis is someone I've been reading about lately. And, you know, rich guy, gave up everything. And at one point, the bishop came to town and wanted him to make some sacrifice. And he gave everything back, including the clothes. In the center of town, he stripped himself naked and gave it all back. And the bishop clothed him in his own robe. And St. Francis wrote that wonderful prayer, God, make me a channel of thy peace. And there are different versions of the prayer. The prayer that I have adopted says channel. And channel is a passage between one thing and another thing, a channel, one person and another person. And I like to believe that tonight on Zoom, we are creating that channel over the bits and the bytes of our electronic world. So make me a channel of thy peace, that where there's hatred, I may bring love. Where there's fear, I may bring the spirit of forgiveness. Where there's discord, I may bring harmony. Where there's error, I may bring truth. Where there is doubt, faith, despair, hope, shadows, light, sadness, joy. Lord, grant that I may seek rather to comfort than to be comforted, to understand than to be understood, to love than to be loved. For it is in self-forgetting that one finds, by forgiving that one is forgiven. It is by dying that one awakens to eternal life. And I, in reading, you know, that letter that Bill wrote about emotional sobriety, I have to practice this love in order to get this love. I have to give this gift away in order to be worthy of it, but also to get more to give away. And in all of the spiritual readings that I've done, including the third, seventh, and the 11th step prayer, it's always about getting rid of selfishness and self-centeredness, of getting myself out of the equation. I find that difficult. And on a daily basis, I need that time in the morning to pray and to meditate and to ask God to come into my life and to help me with that moment, with that day. The other day I was mowing the lawn and I'm having difficulty. I know this is strange to believe, but I'm having difficulty with a person in AA. And I'm mowing the lawn and she's in my head living rent free and I'm going a little crazy. And I finally said, I have to pray for this woman. And I spent that next half hour praying for this woman. And I don't know if she felt any better, but I felt better. And I realized that as Tommy in our group says, it's not them, it's me. You know, that I was raised with some character defects. I still have them. I was talking about this last night at another meeting. I still have those character defects. And little by little, God is chipping away. I'll leave you with one final story that Michelangelo was the sculptor, artist, Renaissance man who created the Pietà. And somebody came up to him as he was carving the statue. And he says, Master, how do you know what to do? How can you create such beautiful art? And Michelangelo said, I chip away everything that is not the Pietà. And in the course of my life, I have to chip away all of those things that prevent me from connecting with God and from connecting with you. And when I can chip away, and it's a lifetime process, and I'll still be chipping at it, you know, long after this talk is over. But if I can keep chipping away, I will become successful in getting closer to God, and most importantly, getting closer to you. Thank you for your life. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you, Bill. Remind me never to invite you to group. Hey, man. So let's just talk about this real quick. Can you call on two people? Just look through this room of squares and just call on two people. They're not going to, it's for you, whoever you pick, and then we'll open it up.
Katie, would you mind?
Katie
in the UK. You came this far.
There we go.
Oh, hello, everybody. I'm Katie, and I'm an alcoholic. And thank you for calling on me, Bill. Thank you so much for your lead. I found that very, very moving, and it was very, very thought provoking, and I loved the reading. I absolutely loved it, and as I was listening to it, I thought, oh my goodness, I was so meant to be here. So I couldn't believe it. And it's made me feel very emotional, and it's kind of really humbled me, hopefully a little bit. And I feel very small, you know, I feel very small because I know I've got work to do. That was wonderful. Wonderful. It was really just so to learn a little bit more about your life and about your spiritual development. And it was wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Katie. I don't know you, but Sue Kay, are you available?
Sue Kay?
I can't do my video, but if you don't mind my speaking without the video, I can do the audio. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I wanted to thank you also. I'm having a big family reunion coming up, and I felt like I needed a little bit of extra support because it's a challenge dealing with my family. And I really felt just kind of that anxiety leave me as you were speaking. About halfway through, it was gone. And I'm like, it's just amazing, this program, how one alcoholic speaking to another alcoholic really makes that difference. And, you know, I feel a lot more centered now. I also enjoyed, I too changed careers mid sobriety and went into teaching. And so I loved your story about making a difference in the lives of other people. I think that's so important. And I also truly believe that my program has made me a much better teacher. I'm really able to have that empathy and have those listening skills that I never would have had I continued drinking. So I'm grateful for your experiences, and thank you for sharing tonight. And I will pass.
Thanks, Sue. Over to you, Sam.
All right. Man, that was really incredible. It amazed me at the, you know, just the depth of life change you can have in different steps in our lives, and how it can just completely shift from being married, living here, doing this to doing that, and then having like that surrender experience. And the next thing you know, you're a different state doing a completely different thing, you know, a whole another chapter of life. And I never imagined my life looking the way that it looks now. I love the way it looks, but I'm just saying I never imagined that. You probably never imagined, rewind the tape 10 years, when you're married to that woman, that you would be in Vermont being a teacher, getting a doctorate with all these, you know, going back to school. So that's really cool. So we'll open it up. Would anybody like to share? Ooh, we got Kristen.
Hi, I'm Kristen. I'm an alcoholic, and I would be remiss to not share. That is, Bill is so absolutely dear to me, and you could not have picked a better speaker to talk about emotional sobriety. He, to me, is really the epitome of it, and it was shocking to hear about his anger, because to me, he has never been anything but kind and loving and absolutely patient and, such a good listener. And I'm so blessed he's in my life. He's my service sponsor, and he practices what he preaches. And when we talk, a lot of times we talk about, me and trying, usually taking on too much and really working on the prioritization and putting what is most important first, and that is God and Alcoholics Anonymous, and then my family, and then the other pieces of it fall where they may. And I was just going through some notes yesterday, and I came across the notes from our last conversation about priorities, and just always a reminder, but just so grateful to hear him, so blessed, like I said, to have him in my life and help guide me along this path and help me to remember what's truly important in life. And, I feel I love you so much, and thank you. Thank you for your talk tonight.
Thanks, Kristen.
What about our friend JP in Vietnam? I've been trying to get in touch with you, see if I can get you to do this one week. JP, are you around? You probably need to go get him. What's up, man? What are you doing?
Yeah, it's nice to see you guys. Busy. Sure. I think Kurt gave me your number, I think, at some point.
Oh yeah, man. We'd love to have you 1 week.
Sure, that would be great.
What's going on, man?
Busy with the program every day. 10, 11, and 12, I think. I finished a recent set of amends a couple of weeks ago, and it's been living in the sunlight of the spirit, I'd say.
Oh, very good, man. Good for you. What about my buddy Chris H? Chris, you there? Are you just are you peeling carrots in your kitchen? Are you around, man?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm in the car listening.
Oh, yeah.
And can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just want to say thanks to Bill. Incredible sharing. And I really resonate, Bill, with what you said about I never imagined that I would have that freedom, or whatever you said, that you just didn't believe that you would be there. And I think that's certainly a feeling that I have wrestled with and even journeyed with again recently, is just looking up to people in this meeting and in other groups, and just hearing this freedom and just having this overwhelming sense of, yeah, not me. And just this feeling, always feeling like the exception to the rule. And tonight, it's just a great reminder that we're really not in control, and that it is about giving up and turning it over to our.
I think my internet's messing up, or somebody's something's going on. Did we just lose Chris? Was that kind of a weird?
Yes.
Did it sound like he was on acid or something?
Yeah,
for the last few minutes.
Yep.
Okay. What about you, Dawn? You want to jump on there? Love you, Chris. Great share. Dawn, you want to share?
Sure, I'm laughing, Sam. I'm trying to stop not calling him on acid, okay?
Oh, yeah, man.
My internet's half unstable, too. But thank you for sharing, Bill. It was good to hear someone who's of a history background. My husband loved history, so it's always nice. It's fascinating to me how people are attracted to different things in the world. But how those passions can really, you know, take us to places that we never expected. So it's really interesting to hear that. I've had quite a bit of shifting around in my life, and I'm surprisingly at peace with it all, like surprisingly. And I think that it has so much to do with, you know, what this reading talks about is me not being attached to things. And, you know, my sponsor passes out these things. If she's willing to give you one, you should get it. It says, show up, pay attention, tell the truth, and don't be attached to the outcome. And sometimes now I'm actually surprised that that's even possible for me. Like it's a thing that has actually been, you know, a promise and a freedom that's come to me that I'm like, wow, I'm surprised at it, because it's been such a an elusive trait to be, you know, detached but not disconnected. And because for the longest time for me, detachment, I just leave and I don't show up for anything for a while, and I just need a couple of days off, thanks. And so that's been nice. One of the things that I've really been aware of today, that's the word keeps popping into my psyche, is compassion. You know, you said it, another person said it, it was already echoing throughout my day. And I think it's nice when I'm able to look at things and when things don't necessarily go the way I think they should, and the arrangements that I would have, the way things would be, and it doesn't happen, and I just smile at it. And it's actually an amazing thing to me that that's possible in my life today. The other thing that I'll talk about is what you mentioned, what I jotted a note that says, I have to practice love in order to get love. And this reading also speaks to that too, that you see us giving things away, and because of that, we receive. And also, there's a part in the book where it talks about, we have to insist upon giving the entire product away. And it is through that, like that you talk about that channel where I become kind of emptied out so that I can receive. And it's, you know, this idea of you can't fill up a glass of water that's already full. You have to kind of, it has to be emptied out. And I've had pretty remarkable experiences through this whole, through COVID. And I think that we have an opportunity, like it talks about when it says in the big book that they got through World War I and, you know, people maintained to stay sober. And I think what we have gone through as a body, our experience through COVID and, you know, who knows where we're at now, but that if we made it through it sober, I think we've grown. And that as a fellowship, we've grown. And I know that I've grown, and I know that a lot of the people that I know have had to really be honest at a different level about what's happening in their life, because all the toys, bells, whistles, and dings got kind of taken away. And, you know, you can't do what you want to do, when you want to do it, how you want to do it. And as a result of that, you know, me being alcoholic, I have to like surrender to life the way it is, not the way I wish it would be. And that went on for quite some time. I don't know whether y'all noticed or not. We were in a sort of a, you know, mess for a little while there. And I think the longevity of that experience for me really made it so that I internalized a lot of the things that I had to swallow, like the bad medicine. I actually internalized it and recovered in ways I never even expected that were possible. So it's one more time when life teaches a lesson from, you know, that thing where it talks, I heard early on in recovery, you used to hear pain is the touchstone of spiritual growth. I hated that. Hated it. I was like, I'd rather see the light than feel the heat, and then I'd set myself on fire, you know. But anyway, the things that have changed my life, alcoholism. You know, realizing that alcohol is a problem. My husband dying, transforming into somebody I didn't know I could stay like sober through something of that emotional magnitude. And then COVID, you know, sit still for a year, a person who's like, I'm the queen of zip into the next adventure. Sit still now. And it just, it's amazing how the things that we go through sober develop us into the people and, you know, have developed me into a person that I would want to be. And I thank AA so much for that. I can't even tell you how grateful I am and surprised. Like there are times when I'm literally surprised at the person that I am, because it's statistically impossible. You know, it just doesn't, it's not real. So anyway, thank you for sharing. And I'm always grateful to the people that host this meeting for us.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you, great share. What about my friend Ed's got his hand up in Grand Junction?
Hi, my name's Ed.
Hey, Ed.
Good to be here, Ed. And I got reminded tonight of this meeting. And I just want to share, when I was new, there was a guy from Connecticut. And I got sober in Southern California. And there was a guy from Connecticut. And he'd always say, this is Sobriety. And I remember an early sobriety, Sister B and Father John, and they'd have a little gathering over. Sister B's and Dr. Paul would come in, and they were talking about emotional sobriety, and I didn't have a clue what it was. Fast forward till I was 25 years sober, and my sponsor there in City of Orange gave me a pen engraved with my name and sobriety date on it. And I said to him, I said, well, I guess I'm an old timer now, right? He said, well, Eddie, we took a vote and you have to have 30 years of sobriety. Well, I moved to Grand Junction. I was 27 years sober. So something happened with that move from Southern California to here. And even though he had said before I was 30, he said, well, we took another vote, you might have to be 35. But when I was 30 years sober, he gave me a medallion that his friend and my friend designs medallions. And on the medallion, it was a picture of Bill and Bob. And there was a little ribbon and it said old timer. So he recognized in me the change that had happened to me. So, you know, this thing about emotional sobriety, it was Greek to me. You were speaking a foreign language. I didn't understand what it was. And it isn't that I did anything special to understand what this whole program is about, the design for living, the essence of the design for living. But my sponsor recognized it in it, and he alluded to me, you finally got it, Ed. And you know, so for me, I guess I was a slow loner. It took me 30 years to get to where I kind of understood what you're talking about, and the peace that I have today, the peace, the serenity, and I owe it all to the men and women like you guys sitting in this room carrying the message as to how to obtain that. And I'm so very grateful that drugs and alcohol got me here, and that you people had the message. And I today can understand what you're saying, that you're not speaking Greek or Martian. So anyway, I want to thank you, and God bless all of you. Have a wonderful night. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
Thank you. What about my friend Joel? Joel, what are you doing, handsome?
My name is Joel, and I'm an alcoholic. That was a great talk, Bill. But several things you said like struck chords with me. Like you said, you were afraid of your anger, but you discovered it in third grade. I was a street fighting man right up until the day I got into AA. And I still wanted to punch people in the nose. And that's when I became afraid of my anger, because it's like a flash anger. I can go from just being pissed off to like full rage. And I've tried to do a lot of work on that. And you said something about the character defects have not been removed, you know, entirely. They still creep up. And that's happened to me recently. I heard Don Pritz once say that alcoholics need to feel useful. And I kind of agreed with that, because I always had a position in AA. I was always, you know, doing service work of once, you know, either a GSI, making coffee, chairperson, you know, sponsees, all that kind of stuff. But this COVID has really thrown a boomerang into my service life. And it's whittled down to the point now where only my very old sponsees call me up occasionally. And I answer the phones for the local intergroup, but that only happens every other week. And I'm feeling this uselessness feeling. So about 2 or 3 weeks ago, I met a guy who wanted me to sponsor him. And I said, sure, you know, but, you know, let me first, before we do this sponsorship thing, see if you're really serious about going through the work. So call me every day and go to the Zoom meetings I go to, and we'll see what happens. So he started calling me, and I started to, I think it was Joe Hawk said, you have to qualify the alcoholic, make sure they're a real alcoholic. So I went over the doctor's opinion and gave him examples out of my life several times. And this guy would interrupt my talks. He would talk when I was talking. I started feeling pissed off every time, you know, we were at the end of the conversation. And I started coming to the conclusion when by now he knows about the phenomenon of craving, and he knows about the insanity of the first drink. And I said, why do you think you're an alcoholic? And he says, oh, when I drink, I go crazy. And I started saying, this guy's not a real alcoholic. I don't know what's going on, but he was aggravating the hell out of me. So I discussed it. I did an inventory. I discussed it with a few people, and I decided to fire him. But now I'm feeling like, shit, maybe God was testing my tolerance. Maybe I should have been more loving and tolerant and the rest of it. But I heard something you said that I can do. You still live in rent-free in my head. I could stop praying for him, you know, and give it to God. So thank you, Bill. I got a lot of your talk.
Yeah, thanks, Joel. That was good to hear you, man. Good to see you. What about Summer B? What are you doing over there, Summer? You look like you got a bad temper. You got anything to add to this conversation?
Hi, everyone. I'm
just kidding.
Oh, I definitely do have a bad temper, that's for sure. Oh, all I know is I don't know what happens when I get on these emotional sobriety meetings. And Bill, your share was amazing. But like, I just start crying sometimes. And when you were saying about the chipping away, it's like I get in these meetings sometimes, and it's not everyone, but some speakers will just, there's like this place in my heart, I guess you get into or something, but it was very, very good. And what you shared about like the work that you do with like the immigrants, like tears were streaming down. It's the program is just so beautiful. I'm very new, by the way. I'm just coming up on a year. I have a year and 21 days. So I'm like so grateful for the program and just all the support you guys have given me. But yeah, it, like there's this love. You were sharing it. I don't remember every little bit, but you come into these rooms and it's like a love like you've never, like even in your own like blood family, you don't get that. You know, there's something so, I can't describe it to you guys, but I feel it when I come in here. And I don't know, I was thinking earlier, like, am I gonna get on the meeting or not? My brother wanted to watch a movie and something told me, no, you gotta get on that meeting, Summer. And I get on here and it's like, I got so much from this meeting. I can't explain. Again, it's like chipping away, I guess. And I thought, you know, I'm past the crying, but there is a lot of pain. Like you shared about the dark night of the soul. And it's like, I'm just wondering, like, how long does it last? You know, I thought I had that like 4 years ago, but it's still, you know, there's a lot of pain, I guess, you have to work through. And it's just things I didn't even know were there. And somehow you guys are able to bring them out. And I don't know if it works that way for everyone, but it's pretty amazing. So I'm kind of embrace it now. I'm learning that, like, okay, it's okay to cry and like feel these things that maybe I've shoved down most of my life. And it's, I don't know, it's amazing to me. I'm like, wow, I did not know it was, you know, this much, this deep rooted, you know. But anyways, thank you so much for your share. And thank you guys for having me here tonight. It's been a wonderful meeting. I'm so glad I was here.
Thank you. You know, some of the most freaky times for me in sobriety have been in those transitional periods, you know, like in between, like when a marriage ended and all of a sudden you're single again for a little while, or, you know, when some kind of big career transition and you don't know how it's going to work out. And like, there's a part of me that one of the guys I'm good friends with always says that I play God in my life by the need to know how it's going to work out. Like I needing to know. And I really think it's cool that all these things show up as soon as it's like, usually I'll go back through the work or I'll go and I'll just let go of these dependencies. And then it slowly starts to show up and bloom into this thing. But I'm the most impatient son of a bitch on the planet. You know, like I don't do well with waiting, like one way or another, you know, even in like, even in a relationship, if it's not going to work out, I don't do well just sitting in discomfort. I'm like, hey, let's just either end this, or, you know, you want to go to divorce, you want to get together, what are we going to do here? You know, with any kind of conflict, I never did well with that just uncomfortable, not knowing thing. And AA's, that's been over the last few years, I've gotten to where whenever I feel that, like, I got to do something, I just let go and breathe and just let that stuff pass through. Anyway, what about Fernando? What's up, Fernando? I haven't seen you a couple weeks, man. Looking good.
Hey, Sam. What's happening? Good to see you. Hi, everybody. My name is Fernando. I'm an alcoholic. And Bill, wonderful, wonderful chair. You know, I love the history. You know, I love going through just listening to you with like going through an autobiography of Bill and AA and emotional sobriety. What a great meeting this was. I always used to ask my sponsor about emotional sobriety, and he always used to say, wait 7 seconds before you react. Wait 7 seconds. And I couldn't wait 2 seconds. I was already reacting. You know, I'm the, he always used to also tell me is act, don't react. And so many great things were said today and have been said in the last year and a half. You know, for me, I don't know who said it a while back, probably a year ago, but they said the basic text has to become the living text. And I have to be the living text. I have to be the person that my wife wants me to be as best I can, as a father, or the employee. And that's why I get on this. I love this meeting because I'm 55 years old physically, but I'm 15 emotionally. I'm still learning how to grow up. That's my problem. And I love what Veronica read, because I just love sitting and meditating to it, because my dependence upon money, upon a job, upon a car, upon a house was all before God. And what I've learned the last year and a half is putting that, my dependence on God, because that's why I had it all backwards. It's like, you know what? Self-reliance versus God-reliance. And I was always into self-reliance. So let me fix it. I'm a fixer. I'm a people pleaser. I'm a codependent. I'm an alcoholic. I'm an addict. Me, me, me. I know I can do it. And it happened last night with my daughter, but I didn't have to react so much because she wants to go off on summer camp. And I just, she's 16. I'm scared. But then I had to remember she's a child of God. She's God's child. God's got her. It's my controlledness when I get in the middle of it. But that's what you guys have taught me. Everybody here, Mary, Kurt, Joe, and Gary, Wendy, Chris, you all have taught me, and I'm learning how to grow up, which is I forgot how to do. I became emotionally stagnant, spiritually stagnant. And I'm loving this meeting, and I think that's enough out of me. Yeah, 6:55. Happy birthday, Corey.
Good to see you guys. Yeah, what about, we got our man, Corey, who's now 4 years sober today. Corey, what are you doing, man? You want to share with us a little bit? He's probably making a grilled cheese and put it on mute. That's all right. We celebrated you. What about Chris? Hey, Chris, I cut you off right in the last part of your when you were on acid. Are you back in? Are you back in the stratosphere?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, thanks for giving me a second chance, Bill. It was great to hear you, particularly because I'm in New Jersey. I actually am driving through the Pine Lands of New Jersey, which is why I lost signal. And I used to live not far from Nutley, so it was great to hear. What you said tonight, especially about not feeling that it was ever going to happen to you, is something that I've struggled with a lot. I think I shared that about this, just always feeling like the exception to the rule, that I'm different than everyone in the program and I'm special, not in all the good ways. And it just is a real encouragement that it isn't about us, and it's about submission and letting go and trusting something much greater than ourselves. And I love what you said about the translation for the St. Francis prayer, because I know that make me an instrument of your peace is often used. But this idea of channeling, and that we are simply to be conduits, it's not about us or what we're able to do, but to be a conduit. And that's exactly what you were tonight. And thank you so much.
All right. Well, it's been a beautiful meeting, Chris. Thank you for your share, Bill. Thank you. Bill, do you have anything further you'd like to add? Is anything you thought of that you may want to tell us before we get off?
Do you have another hour and a half? I could probably do it again.
Yeah, yeah.
No, there are just so many people to thank. I'm very grateful that all of you are here tonight, including members of my group. So it's been a great life, and I want more.
Yeah. Why don't you tell me a little bit about this morning process when you wake up with that bear on your, since you haven't arrived, obviously, with, 30 something years sobriety, what do you have to do in the morning?
Well, I just have to pray. And I think that when I get out of my own way and open that channel, God will come in. And he has never failed me. That's the interesting thing, that as long as I think that's part of this spiritual development that I'm in right now, the end of the year, the struggles with finishing up, grades and all that, I would get up in the morning and I just said, I can't do this, God, help me. And somehow it all got done. And that was where the faith and the trust, it's that story about, the guy on the tightrope, and you watch him walk across, and you know he's going to make it. But then he pushes this wheelbarrow and he asks you to sit in that wheelbarrow. And my fear is that I'm gonna fall. but I have to trust that that God is going to push me across and I'm going to make it to the other side. And he has been doing that now all these years. Why won't I trust him today? You know, and I have had in the last week or so just an incredible sense of peace. And I think it gets keep chipping away. And, you know, from those weeks when I was not feeling that peace to feeling it and knowing that I'm probably going to go back into that bad time again, and then it will cycle itself through. So thanks for asking me to speak, Sam. This has been a great experience.
Yeah, it's beautiful, man. And it was like Mary Thayer was talking about the limitless load in the big book, you know, and the only thing we have to give the whole away. And she asked Gary the other week, like, if he had arrived yet. And you ask these people, you know, they're 50 years sober. I mean, the thing is, it's a process and an adventure. And the right. good news is it's a process and an adventure.
Yeah.
You know, there is no place where we arrive and wear white linen and bless people. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, we might, but we'd still keep going. And we'd still have other dark nights of the souls. Because that's, I think, part of the human condition. All right. Well, we usually end this meeting by muting ourselves and just going to our inner room and saying the Lord's Prayer to ourselves for all who care to join. Corey, you want to say anything about the fact that you missed our meeting when we called on you? Were you watching The Sopranos? Happy birthday, buddy. Love you.
Yeah, thank I you, wanted Sam. To say, I wanted thank to you, apologize for showing up late.
Oh, yeah.
I got all the times wrong.
Oh, we're glad you came, man. JP, call me. Let's hook up. I'd love to have you on. Corey, you looking good. I just saw you got back on. What do you have to say for yourself? Well, unmute. Happy birthday, buddy.
Water, and I heard somebody saying something about a grilled cheese, and I was like,
it's like
I know he didn't say that.
Happy birthday,
thank
buddy.
Thank you so love much. You. I love you guys. Work.